In the year 2077, the planet Venus was the new frontier for an overcrowded, exhausted, nearly desperate Earth. Named for the Roman goddess of love and beauty, this hostile world was no paradise. Colonists and explorers had to adapt to an average temperatures of 900 degrees, a surface pressure of 94 atmospheres, and a dense planet-wide cloud cover made up of something. It went too fast. The real reason for mankind's interest in Venus lay beneath the howling windstorms and ash clouds under the planet's jagged, parched, and hellishly hot surface, a buried secret that had seemingly infinite promise. Someone had come and gone before humans set foot on Venus. The planet was crisscrossed with tunnels carved out of the crust 500,000 years ago by a long-vanished high-technology civilization. The vanished aliens were a source of intense curiosity and hope for the 20 billion inhabitants of Earth. Wave after wave of explorers descended into alien tunnels in search of advanced technology that might have been left behind by the so-called Hiji. Most of the artifacts discovered on Venus had no practical use, and were little more than curiosities. The Hiji had cleaned out most of their useful technology, or so it seemed, until a crotchety old colonial explorer named Sylvester Macklin found a fully functional Hiji spacecraft in a sealed-off tunnel. Instead of reporting his find to the authorities, Macklin decided to try and figure out how to make the strange ship work. He climbed inside and began fiddling with the controls. Eventually, Macklin found the right button, rocket engine ignited, and the ancient ship climbed out of the boiling atmosphere of Venus on a plume of white fire. As soon as the ship was clear of the planet, the thruster stopped and the ship disappeared into what we now know as Tau space. When the ship returned to normal space, Macklin was delighted to find that he was still in Earth's solar system. He was even more delighted to find himself docking with an immense Hiji artifact, a huge space station circling the sun between Venus and Mercury. Macklin's ship parked itself inside a hangar filled with other ships of similar construction. Macklin left his ship and explored the sensational new find with a sense of awe and anticipation. The bad news was that Macklin couldn't reset the guidance system of his ship and get it to go anyway. He was stuck without food or water. He wrestled desperately with controls as he became more and more hungry, thirsty. Towards the end, Macklin knew he wasn't going to go home. He directed his efforts to a new goal. Macklin decided that if he couldn't go back, he could at least signal his discovery to humanity. His death wouldn't be in vain. Macklin figured out how to detonate the fuel cells in his ship. The resulting flash was sighted by NASA, and a mission was sent out to explore. The NASA mission arrived at the Hiji artifact and found hundreds of working faster-than-light Hiji starships, a priceless treasure trove that made the Hiji space station humanity's gateway to the stars. Thus, the alien space starship parking garage earned its name, Gateway. After a series of military confrontations and a narrowly averted war, the government of the major powers on Earth realized that Gateway was too valuable to be given to any one government. The governments agreed to establish a multinational corporation called Gateway Enterprises, often referred to as the Corporation, that would occupy Gateway and exploit the technology of the Hiji. The faster-than-light starships and Gateway are now used for a new form of high-tech prospecting. Human volunteers ride the alien ships in the hope that they will visit other worlds and bring back Hiji machines, tools, and other potentially useful items. Because human scientists still don't know how the ship's guidance systems work, the destinations of these prospecting missions are unknown. For obvious reasons, these missions carry an extraordinary degree of risk. 15% of prospector missions don't come back, and 80% return with little or nothing. The remaining 5% make the risk worthwhile, and can turn ordinary people into instant millionaires. You won the local lottery in December 23, 2101. The prize is a one-way ticket to Gateway, worth $238,575, including a limited partnership in Gateway Enterprises. Transportation to Gateway, 10 days worth of life support in Gateway itself, a class in Hiji ship handling, and an invitation to something or other. A week after you turned in your winning lottery ticket, you boarded an interplanetary ship traveling from Earth to Gateway. It is now Wednesday, May 17, 2102, and you have been aboard Gateway for less than a day. You have been assigned living quarters and a proctor to show you around and get you settled in. Your first ship handling class starts later today. Something else I didn't catch. Welcome to Frederick Paul's Gateway, folks. Part 1. Gateway Prospector. That would be you. Okay, so this particular episode is not going to have any gameplay. We're going to talk about the plan here, and we're going to show you around the interface, because this is a bit weird. So, Gateway is an interactive fiction game. We used to call these text adventures way, way long ago. But this one's a little different from most text adventure games, in that it has limited graphics, as you can see in the upper right-hand corner. It's nicer than most text adventure games in that it has a whole big interface here. So, like, for example, we've got help, half, text, erase, picture status, inventory, and look. We've also got a very limited compass. It's telling us that the only place we can go now is east, which is incidentally out. In text adventures, sometimes a direction will also be in or out. So if you're seeing like E here, in this case it also means out, because it's the only way we can go. So the list of verbs on the left are things that we can do. You can examine, there's a whole lot of them. Examine, take, drop, open, close, look, read, ask, and so on and so forth. And the things that you can interact with are on the right hand side. The stuff that's in this particular screen is the educt or the all is a special command, I'll talk about them in a minute. Bed, blue coverall, boots, debit card, desk chair, and so on. The big thing about text adventures is that there's going to be a lot of reading. So there isn't going to be a lot of actual moving stuff at all. And that's why this is an experiment. If you've watched this far, congratulations. The plan is to give you something sort of interesting to listen to, and occasionally there'll be little bits to watch as well. If the music gets to be a bit much, we'll replace the music with something more palatable. I don't know yet, I haven't thought that through. As I say, there's going to be no gameplay. I just want to show you how this works before we get anywhere. So, if you press F1, you basically get the help system for this game. F1 is this display. This is a bit like some of the Sierra games that I did a long, long time ago. So you'll see stuff that sort of makes sense there. F2 is menu mode, which is what we were in. F3 is half screen mode. F4 is text mode. F5 is status mode, which is a little bit of a mess, but we'll talk about that in a minute. F6 is map mode, which again is also a little bit of a mess, but we'll talk about that in a moment. F7 is inventory mode. F8 is look mode. And F9 is status mode. Those are all the F keys, and I'll show them to you in a second. But the other thing that's important is when you're typing, you can hit tab to get into the mouse mode. Sorry. Mouse mode means that you can use, if you've got the mouse, if you've got the menu up, you can use the mouse on the left-hand side of the screen. You can get through the menu that way. Okay? Backspace deletes the last character, escape, erase all timing, and enter executes command. So, for the most part, if you're in a picture and you're using the mouse, you can left-click to look at it. And if you've got right, if you double-click, you can do obvious things. I need to mention this because this is very important. There is no such thing as a right-click in this game because mice didn't have that many buttons at this point. At the most, some mice had one button, some mice had two buttons, but that was about the extent of it, so they had a left and right button. Okay, and then after that, again, single click, select a word, double click, execute some command. When you're in the menu, you can use the menu like you expect to be able to do it. So tab changes to typing mode, which goes back. Page up and page down, scroll up and down. Home takes you to the top and moves you to the bottom. Shift and letter is a bit weird, we'll move you to a word. So for example, if you're at A and you press Shift and D, you'll go down to the word do, for example. Up and down, move you up and down in the menu, left and right, go to the other menu, because you saw that we had a left-hand menu of verbs and a right-hand menu of stuff that we had. Backspace will delete the last word. If you're in a menu and you're building a sentence, that would be how you deleted the word. Space will select a word from the list, and enter will execute the entire command. Okay. If you're in a picture, you can emulate the mouse by changing to the command menu through tab, using the arrow key to move the mouse cursor. Space or enter to click the mouse button, because remember it's not really a mouse, and then shift and enter double to click. So let me just show you what this looks like and how it works. So F2, for example, is this particular mode here. F3 takes away the menu and leaves you in text mode. Pressing F3 again doesn't do anything, but if you press F2, you go back to menu mode. So if I go into tab, I will be here, and I will be able to move around this. So if I go examine, and I press space, it will put in examine air duct. And I can put and, and then it can make complex sentences. So if I say and bed, this is the kind of thing that you can do with a good text parser. Once I've got the sentence, I can press enter. It will obviously have a problem with this one, because it's asking, you're asking it to look at two things, which it can't do. It can do look and get, but it can't do things like look at twice. You can't use more than one direct object with the verb examine. So for example, if I said examine air duct, then open desk, this will work because it will give me the examine message and then it will open a desk. Actually, that's probably not gonna work. I need draw. Okay, that will work. So, set into the wall is a vent for the life support system and gateway that provides heating, ventilation, and air conditioning. The vent is covered in a metal grate. The message light in the PB comm set is blinking. Don't worry, we'll get to that. You open the drawer and discover a book. The message light in the PB comm set is blinking. That will be a feature until we pick up the PB comm set. So that's how this works. If I have the mouse now, because the mouse cursor showed up, and it's more or less exactly the same thing. Click on examine air duct. Then let's close the drawer. Okay. If I hit OK, enter now, it will do that again. You close the drawer. That's the important thing here. So F5, remember, F5 was supposed to bring me a status mode, but it didn't. F5 just, it doesn't sometimes work. F6, however, is the status mode. You achieve a score of 0 out of 1600. In 4 turns, you have an account balance of $1,500. Okay, so let's go back to F2, there we go. F7, remember, it's supposed to be inventory mode. So if I press F7, I'm wearing some boots, a white badge, and a coverall. That's what I've got on me right now. It's very police questy. I can't exactly work with that screen. I can work with it on the right hand side of here, because if I want to look at, let's say I wanted to look at my blue coverall. Oh, sorry. I'm being silly. There are many ways to look in this game. Try looking at and or inside of the blue coverall. Okay, so if I look at coverall, blue coverall, and I do that, it will tell me about it. The one-piece blue coverall covers your entire body, with the exception of your hands and head. Okay. So anyway, if I press F8, I will be in look mode. Now, look mode is a special mode where it will take away the picture, but it will show you the actual room that you're in. So if you moved now, the bottom half would be for typing, and the top half would always show your text window with the thing that you're currently seeing. And then we have F9, which again is just status mode. Okay, so what is probably going to happen is I'm going to end up playing it like this, okay? And the reason why I'm going to play it like this is because I'm not intending to use the menu. I'm intending to type. Like so, okay? That is probably what we're going to end up doing. If no one's happy with that setup, don't worry, I can change it. But that is about it for this video. I just want you to become acclimatized to the idea of Gateway. I'm not gonna do anything today, we'll do stuff next week, but that is an overview of the interface. So, next week we will start playing. Have a great week, folks, and I will see you next week when we actually do stuff in Gateway. Bye-bye.